Welcome to Critical Thought TV. This is Stuart Dambrot. I'm your host. We're here today with Mark Wigley, architectural theorist, scholar, and author, and dean of the Columbia Graduate School of Architecture, Planning, and Preservation. Welcome. You have spoken and written about architecture as poetry, mm-hmm. Which is a fascinating topic. And I'd like to ask you how that relates to architectural deconstructivism, especially as captured in your book on the subject, Derrida's Haunt. And as part of that, how your thoughts on deconstruction in architecture might have changed between the writing of that book and mm-hmm. today.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, when I say that architecture is a form of poem, and it's a poem with a very particular theme, which is structure. Architects don't make buildings, they make reflections about buildings. Buildings for us are all about structure and organization. So when an architect makes a poem, a thought, even romantic thought, a magical even idea about structure, they're telling us something about structure that we didn't see before. And the normal way we think about structure is that it has a sort of solid base, and you work your way up, and then you can have some fun only if you've done the serious work of having the base. You can make some decoration, let's say, on the outside. Deconstruction is a powerful rethinking of what structure is and suggests that actually what organizes things, what holds things together, it's not a stable base at all. But when you get down to the bottom of something, when you try to locate what it is that allows a structure to stand, what allows an organism to be, what allows existence itself to occur, it's all founded on enigma and gaps. So it's the opposite of what we think about buildings. So if we've always used buildings as our image of stable structure, and then we learn that structure is really not what we thought, then you can look back at buildings and say, okay, what does this tell us about buildings? So my interest in the relationship between architecture and deconstruction was to think of it the other way around. In which way are buildings actually not just riddled with enigmas and gaps and mysteries and confusion, but those enigmas, gaps, mysteries, and confusions are the very magic of buildings, are the great strength of buildings.
So you can actually almost intuit the ghostly voice of Heidegger saying, why is there anything rather than nothing?
Yeah.
Right, in a sense. Huh?
Well, and of course, Derrida is following Heidegger so closely because of course, Heidegger is part of a very long tradition in philosophy of using architecture as the central metaphor for his thinking. In fact, even as far back as Plato, when Plato has the idea of ideas and he has to explain what an idea is, he says, think of the person who makes a building. First they have the idea, and then they make the building, the object that comes out of that idea. So architecture has always had this intimate role within philosophy. So when philosophy shifts as strongly as it did through Heidegger and Derrida, the question is, well, what happened to architecture in that maneuver? And did architecture stop being so useful for the philosopher, or did it become more useful? And what I was trying to argue was, of course, that the very thing, the destabilizing aspect of deconstruction, the undoing of our normal understanding of structure, this instability is at the very heart of the beauty of architecture and is the very thing that attracts architects to buildings. Architects are not attracted to buildings because buildings stand and represent. Architects are attracted to buildings because they find them infinitely mysterious. They find them full of enigmas, paradoxes, confusions.
I see. So I see how some of Derrida's views and writings does speak directly to that in terms of questioning the relationship between thinking and the thinker, or oneself in relation to observing one's own thoughts. There's a shift in perspective.
Yes.
That's massive in a way.
Yes. I'll give you a small example. For example, when you're in a room,
what is a room?
It seems straightforward. I'm me, and I'm inside a room. But actually, if you think about it, when we are in a room, firstly, when you're really in a room, you're not aware of the room. Right?
Quite right.
It's only the sense of being in is exactly that moment where the room itself disappears. Now when I look at the room and think about it, suddenly all the things that I take for granted in rooms become very strange. For example, all the detailings of a room all the moldings are designed to hide from you the fact that the relationship between the wall and the floor is very insecure, that buildings are moving, that everything is uncertain. So a room, that thing that is we take for granted so strongly that we are unaware of them when we're inside them, once you really look at a room, that certainty falls apart. Like, for example, here we are sitting together in this studio. We really don't know why we are not falling to the ground. We're six floors up, right? We have no evidence. We just believe that this is likely not to happen. But you and I, we don't know why. And I'm the architect, and I, in theory, I should be able to tell you why. We don't. Why is this? Because structure, that which allows something to stand, in this case a building, is precisely that which you could never see. Right? The foundation of a building, that which allows a building to stand, if I show you the foundations, the building will fall. So that which allows this room to be, that which allows us to be here, that which allows us to be in, is precisely not available to us. So it's mysterious, it's uncertain. Instead, we have images. We have walls, carpet, right? So we are here together suspended in a set of images that represent the idea of a room, but we are actually not in a room as such. We're in a set of representations of the thought of a room.
So that, to me, I may be getting this incorrectly, but that seems to be a very good explanation of why Derrida was anti-Platonic in a way.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, which I can relate to because I am as well, but for other reasons until right now.
Right, right. So the key strength of Derrida's argument, I think it's probably the most misunderstood of writers, and perhaps this is a great compliment to be so misunderstood. But revealing the fact that structure doesn't stand on stable foundations does not mean that the structure falls. Deconstruction is not about the dismantling of the great assumptions of the West, of the great traditions of the West, of the so-called certainties of our life. It has the opposite effect. It says, what's so strange is that the certainty is founded on uncertainty, derives its strength from this. Mm-hmm. The classical way of thinking would be to say, if I expose an uncertainty, then the structure becomes weak. The deconstruction is the demonstration that strength comes from enigma and paradox and the abyss in a Heideggerian sense. So, of course, what this means is that to think about deconstruction in architecture is not to, as it were, undermine those fantasies we have about what buildings represent, but to respect those fantasies so, so deeply, because what we believe about buildings, what we even experience because our belief is so strong, is in fact based on mystery. When we invite an architect to make a building for us, or even a builder to build, we don't ask for mystery and confusion, and we ask for certainty and clarity and self-representation, all these things. But the experience that we're going to have with this object is a strange experience.
I can see it. And again, this is a new intellectual venture for me, but it seems then that rather than being a rational process by which we construct an efficient structure that's stable, architecture becomes very almost emotional in a way. There's an emotionality that leads to, because poetry is a way of, and art, communicate emotion rather than logic in a way.
Yeah, and I would interpret your word emotion here as a reference to sort of complexity.
Yeah, something like that.
So we use the word emotion because emotions we think of as a kind of a weather system, as something as complex as the weather. And yes, in that sense, exactly right. If you look at the sort of official representation of buildings and of cities, they are all about certainty and security and stability. If you talk to people about their actual experience of buildings or cities, suddenly all certainty goes out the window and it becomes something we would call emotional. But this does not mean imprecise. In fact,
I know you didn't intend that,
but the more precisely we talk to each other about our relationship with objects, the more complex this description becomes. Also, the more scientific it becomes, this complexity increases.
Emotions is
even a more technical description for the fact that buildings are extremely weird. They just are. And also, and the children know this, right? Children know. Right. For children, buildings are strange. Every closet is haunted. Every house tells a story. Part of what it is to be trained to survive in our society is to be trained to think that buildings don't have secrets. But of course, the moment you turn the lights out, everybody's deep feeling that buildings are alive comes back.
Not to mention what or who might be living in the basement.
Right. And so in this sense, architecture is and has always been haunted. And this is not just to say, look, buildings that should be so straight and ordinary and upright have this weird secret life. Even the idea that a building should represent dignity and certainty and security is to credit the building with life. Think of the simple thing that everybody wants their house to represent them. Maybe they're living in the suburbs in the house, there should be a beautiful lawn in the front and so on. And they would say, my house represents my family. But actually, you don't want your house to represent your family. What if you're having a terrible day? Do you want your house to tell the street that you're having a huge argument and there's a lot of misbehaving going on? No, the house represents a kind of version of you that you would prefer the world to know. So this idea that your house should represent you as a stable, secure, steady kind of a person, that's just as weird as looking for the opposite from a house. So again, one of the effects of this way of thinking is to no longer differentiate between, let's say, strange buildings, exotic structures made by architects trying to accomplish complex representational tasks, and what seems to be the opposite, a building that's just simply trying to be, let's say, ordinary. Because this building that's trying to be ordinary is as weird as you could possibly imagine.
Yeah, I could see it. So in summary, it's almost possible to say. And also, when I thought about emotion, I was thinking of my response to Cooper Union, which it had an emotional component, which I thought was good, because I'll have an emotional response to art, to poetry as well.
Yeah. What I'm saying is that emotional word, and I like that word very much, we can also replace that with a word like scientific. In other words, if we are more precise about your relationship to the Cooper Union, that will be in the world of what we call emotions.
Quite right.
Whereas the official version, which is that the building stands there in front of you and you stand opposite. Let's say it another way. We also use the word emotion when the level of complexity is such that we can no longer differentiate ourselves from the thing that we are looking about. We have become emotional about it. So when I look at the Cooper Union in its official guise as a steady institutional building with a certain history and so on, I can see myself to be outside it and then eventually to enter it. When we say emotional, I can no longer separate. I'm a part of this thing that I look at.
So in summary then, perhaps in closing on this fascinating part of our conversation, the contextual nature of Derrida's most famous observation speaks not only to architecture, but to a wide range of human experience. And in that sense, we can't then, I would imagine you would say, we can't really separate ourselves from the rooms and structures that populate the results of architectural theory.
Yeah, Derrida is making one brilliant observation, that you can never draw so easily a line between inside and outside, between us and the world.
That's beautiful. Thank you very much.